Good morning. Thank you for coming out on this, I guess, rainy morning with all the traffic to our conference on torts, recent developments in tort law and mass tort practice. Before we begin this, I would like to express thanks to the Coalition for Litigation Justice, our sponsor, also to our Alumni Association for sponsoring our reception at the end of the day, and of course all of the speakers that we will have. Our first speaker today is Ken Feinberg, who is here as a part of the LIPIS speaker series, and we have brought in some exceptional speakers for this series the last few years, and one of the problems when you do that is that each time you have a harder time matching what you did before. So a couple of years ago, we had Harvey Miller, and then after that, we had Larry Lessig, and now we have Ken Feinberg. So I think we've done a pretty good job with keeping moving in that positive trajectory. Before I invite Ken up to speak, I feel a little bit like I'm in a classroom with everybody sitting way at the back. If you would like, there are plenty of spaces up front. It certainly... it's not every day that we get a speaker of this caliber, and I would very much like to see everybody up front if you can. Okay, having said that. All right. Thank you, Mark. You know, I was telling Ken before I came up here that I always feel very strange introducing speakers that people know much better than myself. Ken is truly one of those speakers that really you don't have to introduce. And if you did try to list everything that he has been involved with and the things that he's accomplished, I would eat all of his speaking time. So instead of doing that, I'll just run through a few high points. Of course, Ken has managed some of the largest and most complex settlement compensation funds of the last 15 years. Before that, he worked on some very high-profile cases, including Agent Orange. He worked with some of the asbestos litigation, if I recall that correctly, Ken. And is currently the founding and managing partner of Feinberg Rosen. Ken very graciously agreed to be here today, we are just, I can't, words escape me to say how excited I am to have him here. Without any further ado, I'll just turn it over to Ken. You didn't come to listen to me anyway. So thank you, and let's have a warm welcome for Ken Feinberg.
Thank you very much, Todd. I'm really here today for three reasons. First, Natasha Brown, to Todd Brown, to me, back to Todd Brown, to Natasha Brown, back to Todd Brown, to me, to Todd Brown, to me. Finally, not only am I glad to be here, but when you keep getting these emails and messages from the Browns urging me to get up here, I'm glad to come, and that's reason number one. Reason number two, the topic. This is a one-day program raising some very, very interesting issues that are front and center right now in our legal system and as a matter of public policy. So anytime you're gonna have a chance to really get into the details of a lot of this, and look at some of the key issues, terrific. Thirdly, I must say, Todd made it pretty clear the nature and quality of a very sophisticated audience. And that's important. We don't have to start today with, chapter one. This is sort of an advanced course, I must say, and I want to make sure I leave plenty of time for Q&A. Before this session's over at 10 a.m. I want to make sure that people have a chance to ask questions, provide alternative issues, arguments, etc. Joe is here, Joe Bellick, who, along with his colleagues, made the 9/11 Victim Compensation Fund work. 1,500 people received pro bono assistance from ATLA, Trial Lawyers Care, the ABA, the legal community, pro bono. The 9/11 Fund would have never worked without guys like Joe willing to step up pro bono and represent people. And, you know, we know from whence he comes and what he speaks, he has great credibility. My friend Lloyd Dixon is here today from RAND. RAND is doing cutting-edge research into the whole problem of aggregation, asbestos, the lessons learned from the 9/11 Victim Compensation Fund. He's on a panel later today, just doing great work. So it's people like Lloyd and Joe and a lot of others that I think will make this program qualitatively very, very worthwhile. My old friend Joe Donato, another reason to be up here in Buffalo to see Joe, who I've known for many years and who's been involved in funding and watching and observing the mass tort litigation, a true resource, and he's here today. So that's the third reason. Now, the powers that be have asked me to talk on the topic of administrative compensation and settlement plans. Let me set the stage as the keynote first speaker for some issues and topics that are sure to be addressed today. I can provide you in 30 to 45 minutes a blueprint of issues that tie right into the panels that are going to be discussed throughout the day today. I start with the following obvious, maybe obvious to this crowd, not so obvious to the public, obvious first principles. Every once in a while in American life, rarely, but once in a while, there is a catastrophe. And the catastrophe so impacts the American people and policymakers, judges, elected Congress, state legislatures, presidents, attorneys general. The tragedy so triggers an emotional response that policymakers decide there better be a better way. There's got to be a better way to compensate innocent victims than the conventional tort system. The pressure mounts. 11 days after 9/11, Congress enacts the federal September 11 Victim Compensation Fund of 2001. A fascinating statute. Read it. Read it. You'll never see it again. You'll never see a statute like that again. Never. But it offers a fascinating alternative to the conventional tort system. 3 weeks after the BP oil spill in the Gulf, BP shakes hands with President Obama. And they create the Gulf Coast Claims Facility as a voluntary alternative to the tort system. I doubt you'll ever see this again either. Maybe, but I doubt it. The GCCF, in its 16 months of existence, receives 1,200,000 claims from 50 states. I didn't know the oil had got to Alaska or New Hampshire or Buffalo. I got 400 claims from New York State. 50 states and 35 foreign countries. We paid out as an alternative to the tort system $6.5 billion in 16 months before the first trial in the case was even scheduled. Paid out 220,000 releases in lieu of tort. It worked. They're having problems down there now. I'm watching like you are. It worked. 3 months ago, GM decides on its own. This ignition switch problem in certain GM automobiles is posing a huge political and potential financial burden to GM. We will, on our own, create a separate, voluntary GM ignition switch compensation program. Anybody who wants to get the money, if they're eligible and can satisfy the rules of the protocol, come on in. You don't have to, but if you want to. That program is up and running now, as you know. GM estimated, engineering-wise, 13 deaths caused by the ignition switch. In the first 6-7 weeks, we've already found 24 deaths caused by the ignition switch and injuries, etc. Now, point number one in our blueprint. These programs are exceedingly rare. You show me a public compensation program funded by the taxpayer, 9/11, or by the alleged tortfeasor, GM, BP, to the tune of billions of dollars. I consider these programs precedents for nothing. For nothing. They're interesting to analyze. They're interesting to study. I do not think they're going to replace the American legal system, tort system. And yet, there they are. And they're worth studying and spending some time on. We can learn some lessons from these programs. But one very important lesson to learn from these programs is they are aberrations. I do not think they are precedents for anything long term. They are isolated examples of a policymaker response to an inadequate legal system that delays compensation, promotes uncertainty, and guarantees the innocent victim nothing. And therefore, occasionally, what? 3 times in the last 13 years. Here is the program. Here it is. Take a look. Voluntary. Voluntary 9/11. Everybody took advantage of it. Voluntary BP. Virtually all the claims were settled. Voluntary GM. We'll see, but I think everybody who has an eligible claim will come into the GM program. Aberrations. Lawyers who criticize these programs in good faith, and I think it is good faith, this is not what we learned in law school, 9/11, BP, GM. This is not the way we do things in this country. I tend to agree with that criticism, tend to agree with it. Nevertheless, policymakers having decided we ought to try something unique in these limited situations, so be it. Point number one, lawyers need not fear a dire future with more and more of these type of alternative programs. You can put them on one hand. Point number two, this sophisticated audience understands point number two. There is a huge difference between 9/11, BP, and GM on the one hand, and all these other programs that we read about, One Fund Boston Marathon bombings, the Hokie Spirit Memorial Fund at Virginia Tech, the Newtown, Connecticut shooting of the first graders and the creation of a fund, the Aurora, Colorado movie shooting, Dark Knight, 13 shot dead, ba-bum. All of those claims, all of those programs have nothing to do with the tort system. All of those programs are cousins of BP, GM, 9/11, but those systems are funded by private donations. They're a gift. There is no release. You do not make a voluntary choice to waive your right to sue. You can take that money, and if you want, turn around and hire a lawyer and sue Virginia Tech, or the city of Boston, or the movie theater owners in Colorado. Those programs, which the public tends to meld together, merge with BP and compensation programs, they're all compensation programs. Well, they are all compensation programs. Innocent victims get paid based on criteria we establish. But those programs are not alternatives to the tort system. They're 501c3 donor gift money. And you can take that money, unlike BP 9/11, and you can turn around and litigate. Now, I keep asking Lloyd Dixon at RAND this question. How come when people take the money that's a gift with no release, how come they don't sue? They don't. How come they voluntarily take the money and walk away? They can turn around and sue. In Virginia Tech, we paid 100 people, distributed about $7 million. 4 of 100 people brought a lawsuit against Virginia Tech. They won, reversed on appeal, but they won in the district court. Only 4%. Why didn't everybody sue? In Aurora, Colorado, I would have thought, having distributed $5 million, that the victims of that movie shooting would turn around, hire a lawyer, and sue Lowe's or whoever owned the movie theater. Absence of security. As far as I know, nobody sued. Why? Why don't people sue when they've got this money that can fund lawsuits? Don't tell me they can't win. I mean, we're way beyond that. I mean, maybe somebody, they can't win. When does that ever stop anybody from suing? So I've asked Lloyd, Lloyd's got a big research agenda, but I've asked Rand to take a look at that issue. And of course, I think they are. We'll see. We'll see. So that's the second point today. Let's focus on alternatives to the tort system and not spend too much time focusing on who gets what compensation. We can certainly discuss criteria and other eligibility requirements for these alternatives to the tort system, but that's the second question. Third question today. When you set up these alternatives to the tort system, why is there such an overwhelming participation rate? What is it about these alternative systems, 9/11, BP, GM? What is there about these alternative systems that innocent victims find so appealing that the voluntary subscription rate is way over 90%. In 9/11, we received 7,300 claims, death and physical injury arising out of 9/11. 5,300 were eligible. Only 94 people decided voluntarily to litigate rather than come into the fund. 97% signed up. A success. And of the 94 that opted out, all 94 settled their claim 5 years later. There was no trial, ever, on 9/11. BP in the Gulf, 92% eligible claimants with business losses entered the fund. $6.5 billion paid out in 16 months. Why? Why does everybody, virtually, the great, great majority, opt out of the tort system into these funds? Efficiency? Speed? Generosity? What is the contrast between certainty? What is the contrast between these settlement funds, aberrations they may be, and conventional tort litigation? It's the third question. A policy question for the experts. Why? Why? Question number four for today. Why aren't there more of these funds? I say they're aberrations. I'm absolutely right about that. Take a look. Empirically, they're aberrations. They come along rarely. Why? Why, despite the success of these settlement funds, are they still lone exceptions to conventional tort? And what five? Question five. In the future, and the future is now, will we see a proliferation of these funds? I don't think so, but it's worth discussing. Why? Point number six. I express real reservations about the very funds that I design and administer. What are my reservations? Well, we ought to talk about this today. I'll tell you some obvious reservations about these funds, like 9/11, BP, GM. I have a philosophic problem with these funds, and I have a practical, constitutional problem with these funds. My philosophic problem is, why just these innocent victims? What about everybody else? You better be careful about setting up programs that benefit only a very few people. Everybody else, fend for yourself. You should have read some of the emails I received during my administration of the 9/11 Victim Compensation Fund. Dear Mr. Feinberg, my son died in Oklahoma City. Where's my check? Dear Mr. Feinberg, I don't get it. My daughter died in the basement of the World Trade Center in the original 1993 attacks committed by the very same people. Where's my check? And it didn't end with terrorism. Dear Mr. Feinberg, you got to explain something to me. Last year, my wife saved three little girls from drowning in the Mississippi River, and then she drowned a heroin. Where's my check? You better be careful as a matter of political philosophy in setting up funds that benefit only these people. 9/11, my goodness. Not only benefiting only these people with taxpayer money yet. Everybody else, well, I mean, you know, you go through the conventional tort system. Good luck. But for you people, we have a special compensation program. Now, I think the 9/11 fund was the right thing to do. I absolutely do. It was sound public policy at the time. Don't ever do it again. Not with public money. Just you people. Everybody else, no. I'm not talking about FEMA. I'm not talking about services. I'm not talking about rebuilding communities. I'm talking about cash in your pocket. So there's a philosophic problem. Then there's a very practical problem, I must say. In the interest of promoting efficiency, speed, certainty, the decision is made by policymakers, Congress, the White House. We will delegate all of the responsibility to design and administer these special programs to one person. That's it. No committees, no checks and balances, no access to the courts. This is it. If you don't like it, voluntarily opt out and go litigate. But if you want to come into one of these programs, great. Ken Feinberg will do these programs, and there's no, it's all up to him. No checks and balances. No appeals. No second guessing. This is it. Good luck. The 9/11 Fund, in its original statutory guise, it was worse than that. The 9/11 Fund, if you read it, delegated to the Attorney General, who delegated to me the authority to design and administer a program in which every claimant had to blind come into the program, not knowing what he would she would get, and no appeal. Well, we changed that by regulation to at least give people the right to have a free preview of what they would get before they voluntarily decided whether to participate. I mean, people here know all about administrative law. The idea that you delegate to one, the plaintiff lawyers who are critical of these programs, I think have a very good point to make here. I don't care who the person is, institutionally, these ad hominem delegations to one person, let them do it, fine, let her do it, great, that's it, no appeals, if you don't like it, tough, don't participate, raises serious problems. A sixth issue to talk about today. A sixth issue. Then there's a very important seventh issue, and very relevant to today's syllabus in the panels. Contrast 9/11, BP, GM with the conventional tort system. What is there wrong about the conventional tort system that encourages policymakers on rare occasions to say, broke, it's broken, let's set up a whole new regimen? Well, forget for a minute the public's perception, including elected officials' perceptions about, you know, lawyer greed, delay, uncertainty, all that stuff I read about. But from a technical point of view, from a legal, analytic point of view, what is there about the conventional tort system that sort of gives credence, legal credence, and credibility to completely alternative systems? Well, I'm looking at your syllabus today. I'll tell you a couple of things. I'm a big believer in the tort system. I think the tort system works pretty well, actually. I'll tell you one thing, even if you don't think it works pretty well, get over it. Because the tort system is so ingrained in the fabric and history of the country, it's not changing. So I love when I hear these, I read these academic papers, we ought to replace the tort system. I go to the last page, to the summary. You gotta be kidding. The tort system isn't going anywhere. And I think, frankly, the tort system in every village and city and town and hamlet in this country works pretty well. Where it fails is with mass litigation, aggregation, you see. Where it fails is when it's not one person who got hit by an automobile or a fender bender, or somebody fell off a ladder. That's tort one, you got the textbook, go for it. It's when you've got thousands of people falling off the ladder, or thousands of automobile accidents, or millions of victims. Now, what do you do? What do you do? Now, I must say, I think, my own personal view, the Supreme Court has 9 distinguished former judges on the court. They don't get it. They don't get it. What do you do about mass aggregated torts? It's not an ideological thing. I think that in this area of aggregation and mass tort consideration, Amchem and Ortiz and Walmart and AT&T, Supreme Court consistently rejecting aggregation in the courtroom. consistently rejecting at least Rule 23 aggregation in the courtroom, to the great detriment, it seems to me, of efficiency and prompt resolution. And I think that these cases, like Amchem 25 years ago or whenever, and most recently Walmart and AT&T, send a signal. Well, when it comes to mass aggregation, we don't know what the solution is, but it isn't aggregation. Not aggregation under Rule 23, and not aggregation through arbitration, and you figure it out, policymakers. Well, one way you figure it out is by saying, it'll take too long, it won't work, we can't get the cases together, we'll set up a completely alternate system like GM or BP or 9/11. The single biggest problem I see confronting the judicial system as a viable, receptive mechanism for resolving mass tort litigation is aggregation, and you can't aggregate. Oh, you go to bankruptcy, oh, that's great. That's just great, bankruptcy's the answer. So, number 7 or number 8 is the flip side of examining the settlement programs that I'm involved in. It's rather this question: what's wrong with the tort system when it comes to mass litigation, and what are the solutions? That's worth the price of admission today from our experts. What's the solution in the judicial system? If you don't want more BP, and you don't want more 9/11, and you don't want more GM, fine. I don't either. You got a better idea? What is it? What is the better idea? If you can't aggregate the claims in one forum in a meaningful way to provide prompt, consistent, certain result, I give Judge Barbier tremendous credit down in New Orleans. He scheduled the first BP trial less than 2 years after the spill. I never heard of such speed in the courtroom. Mass litigation like that, within 2 years, he had it set for trial. Of course, I was out of business then, having settled 220,000 cases for $6.5 billion. So the critics who don't like these alternative systems that they see as a threat to the conventional system, fine. Now, put up on the board today, during today's debate, the Buffalo solution. That's what I want to hear about, starting with aggregation. Because any problem, any solution that calls for one at a time encourages policymakers to look out of the box and say there's got to be a different way, you see. There's got to be a better way. And it starts with aggregation. And one benefit of the 9/11 fund, BP, GM, there is presumptively by definition aggregation. Anybody who doesn't want to go into the tort system, come in. Once your claim is being processed, it's substantially complete, you will be paid in 60 days. Sign the release. 60 days. And you're all aggregated. Just bring them in. We'll move them. How do you aggregate? Next question for today. At least a little bit of a teaching aid in asking what's the alternative. Next question. There are some innovative alternative ideas when it comes to aggregation. I mean, let's face it, in the absence of Rule 23 and bankruptcy, there is some interesting MDL work going on in the area of aggregation. And what Judge Weinstein in Brooklyn calls the quasi-class action, I love that, a typical Weinstein phrase. The quasi-class, Eldon Fallon in New Orleans, Judge Fallon with Chinese Wall Board and Vioxx, and Judge Weinstein with Zyprexa. The quasi-class. Well, we can't call it Rule 23. The Supreme Court won't let us, so instead we'll use the MDL and our power to concentrate and aggregate and go that way. And hopefully we'll come up with a solution that will voluntarily entice state claims and state settlements as well. So there's some work going on. The problem with that solution, you have to ask yourself, is Weinstein's 94 years old, Eldon Fallon is getting on, and besides, those are just two federal district judges that sort of wax creatively in this problem. How many else are there? How much of a band-aid can it be? Maybe, I don't know. Want to listen? What are the alternatives, and how does the MDL or other creative forms of aggregation help answer the questions I'm posing? Now, once you aggregate the next issue, number 8 or number 9 in my blueprint, how do you go about resolving the claims once aggregated? Bellwether trials, or you pick one out of a hat, or I don't know. Weinstein's a big believer in epidemiology and statistical analysis in terms of trying a couple of cases and extrapolating from that. I don't know. But aside, once you aggregate, question, the next question, then what? Somehow you've aggregated, but how do you resolve them without one at a time, one at a time? Got to deal with these questions as a practical matter. Next issue on my blueprint for discussion today. These questions now, I say for discussion today, we've now extended this seminar for 3 days because all of these questions, we can't get them all done in one day. Next question. There's an emphasis in this program, as on most mass tort programs, with the issue of asbestos litigation. Now, I must say, I don't want to put a damper on this discussion today, but ask yourself what Sheila Birnbaum says every time I hear Sheila talk about mass torts. Sheila always emphasizes the fact, look, asbestos is unique as a mass tort. Don't lump asbestos with Vioxx and Celebrex and Bextra and 9/11 and GM and traumatic injuries and drugs. Asbestos should be viewed as a singular, separate, segregated public policy problem because of its pervasive use, because of its latency period, because of problematic science and medicine in terms of serious, not whether, but to what extent injury. And Sheila takes the position, I think this is fair to say, even though she's not here, whatever solutions or however you want to deal with asbestos, don't extrapolate from asbestos, asbestos equals mass torts. Asbestos is a mass tort, but the problems associated with asbestos should not drive the legal discussion about mass tort litigation, because asbestos is so unique in its ideology, in its harms, in its pervasive use, that it's the tail wagging the mass tort dog. You can talk about asbestos because asbestos is a problem still in need of a solution, but don't extrapolate from asbestos to everything else. Is that right? And how much is that right? So that's another topic. Next on my issue list, we're now into the second week of this seminar, but next on my discussion, and this bothers the Supreme Court, and justifiably, I think. When you talk about efficiency, speed, aggregation, what about due process? What about what Justice Ginsburg likes to talk about? Well, it's all well and good to talk about aggregation, but the reason I am striking down AmChem and asbestos consolidation, at least in part, is How do we know that each individual aggregated victim will be treated fairly? How do we tie the twin tension, the twin problem, aggregative efficiency versus individual treatment of a claim? How do we deal with mass litigation and at the same time remember in the horse and buggy idea, the idea that each claimant is entitled to his or her day in court and ought to be treated fairly, with integrity and dignity? What about the tension between aggregative justice, the trains are running, speed? Well, I'm just a number. I don't have any, I don't even know my lawyer class or aggregation. I don't know, I'm flotsam and jetsam, just being pushed down the river. I don't know anything, I don't know, help me. How do we meld and integrate due process procedural considerations into the well-respected goal of efficient aggregation? You can't try cases one at a time. Yeah, that may be right, but you can't treat people like they're a number. So how do you temper or deal with that tension? Big issue. Now, what we've done, 9/11, a GM, and to a certain extent, BP. Anybody who files a claim with these special funds that wants the opportunity to be heard privately and confidentially, as part of the submission of their claim, we will invite you in for a private hearing under oath with a reporter. Now, you don't have to come, but if you want, just we'll sign you up and you will have your day as part of this aggregative scheme. We'll give you your opportunity to be heard. Now, I must tell you, in my experience, that is the most difficult, challenging, and harrowing part of what I do. What I do in designing and administering alternative compensation systems, it's not rocket science. The people in this room, the sophisticated crowd, you could do exactly what I do, and you might be able to even do it better. I have no pride of authorship in saying that my experience gives me a secret or a better understanding of how to design criteria and compensation levels and calculations. Please, the people in this audience, you could do it if you were asked. I'm asked, I do it. You could do it. That's not the most difficult part of the assignment. It really isn't. But when you do these programs and you give people the opportunity to be heard, brace yourself for the emotion and the horror and the tragedy and the chilling aspect of this. Because you do become, to a certain extent, Solomon when you listen to people who come in to see you privately. In 9/11, I conducted 950 separate hearings with victims and their families. I'll bet you there weren't five people that came to see me that wanted to talk about money. Not five, one hand. They came instead for two reasons. One, to vent about life's unfairness. Mr. Feinberg, I lost my wife in the World Trade Center. Why her, Mr. Feinberg? She was an angel. Why am I now moaning her loss? Where is the justice in this world? There is no God. There is no God. There couldn't be. How could God allow such a thing? I lost my daughter. I lost my son. I lost my father. I lost my mother. Where is the justice? It's not about justice. There is no justice. This compensation program is mercy, not justice. You hear that over and over again from people who just want the opportunity to look you in the eye, the individual tasked with this program, and vent. Or people come to see you not to vent, but rather to validate the memory of a lost loved one. Mr. Feinberg, I lost my wife in the World Trade Center. We were married for 25 years, and I'd like to start this hearing by showing you a video of our wedding 25 years ago. What an angel. See, Mr. Feinberg? Now look, Mr. Jones, you don't have to show me that video. It'll have no bearing whatsoever on your compensation, and it'll just be very You're going to watch. You're going to watch what those murderers did to my darling. Play the video. My office in 9/11 was filled with memorabilia. Videos, audio tapes, ribbons, medals, diplomas, certificates of good conduct, graduation. Unbelievable, my room was filled with the stuff. Validating the memory. Now, why important? Important because I learned under this topic of due process. Do not underestimate the importance of giving people the opportunity to be heard. Now, it undercuts efficiency. It really does. And it undercuts a speed. You better do it. If you don't do it, people feel like they're being railroaded, that they're just being pushed. And when you do listen, and when you do hold these hearings, you better be a good listener, and you better be careful what you say. Because there is nothing you can say that will temper the tension, the emotion. Mrs. Jones, I'm Ken Feinberg, and you're going to receive, for the death of your husband, $5 million. I am? I got a better idea. You keep the $5 million. Bring my husband back. How's that? Mrs. Jones, I wish I had that power. I don't. Yeah. You're offering me money? I've lost my husband, and you're here weeks after 9/11, and you're throwing a check at me? Thank you very much. Angry, 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 angry. Be careful what you say. I remember at the Pentagon, a 78-year-old man comes up to me crying. Mr. Feinberg, I lost my son at the Pentagon. When the plane hit the building, he got out. He escaped from the Pentagon. But he thought his sister was trapped. She worked at the Pentagon also. He went back in to look for his sister. She had escaped through a side door. He died looking for her. Then this elderly gentleman says to me, tears streaming. He goes, my life is over, Mr. Feinberg. It's not written that a father should bury a son. My life is over. I'll never be the same. And I looked at him, well-intentioned, and I said to him, Mr. Jones, this is a terrible tragedy. I know how you feel. Wrong thing to say. This gentleman, nice man, looks at me, he's crying, and he says, Mr. Feinberg, you've got a tough job, really. I don't envy what you're doing. I have a bit of advice for you. Don't tell me or anybody else that you know how I feel. You have no idea how I feel. And I know you didn't mean it, but get that sentence out of your presentation. Well, I'll never do that again. I'll never do that again. You learn when you do these programs, lessons like that. People ask me, is your law degree a help when you do these programs? I think my law degree is probably a wash. A divinity degree would be better, or a degree in psychiatry, because that's the tough part, you see. But if you don't permit due process, tailored treatment, you're in trouble here. Now, the problem is you can't give people a 9/11 type hearing in BP when there are 1.2 million claims. Volume overwhelms your ability to provide that type of one-on-one discussion. So what you do is you try and compromise. Look, we can't give you a hearing, but we will set up 35 claims offices throughout the Gulf of Mexico, Texas, Alabama, Mississippi, Florida. We'll set up Louisiana. We'll set it up. And you can come into any one of those local Gulf offices and meet, not a hearing, but meet with a live face body to talk about your claim. We did that. Of some help. It's sort of like, you know, when you call up Verizon or somebody and you say, you know, you get the automatic push 1, push 2, push 3, push 27, push 29. You're trying to get a hold of a live voice. Same thing, we tried to provide people a live voice, sort of a compromise between just electronic filing of your claim and the 9/11 tailored hearing instead, because of volume, something in between. But that in between is a very important part of any discussion today. Because any discussion of mass torts has to involve this issue, which underlies all of the major opinions in this area. How do you tailor an aggregative solution, a mass solution, to individual treatment of a claim? So that's another problem to be addressed. Next issue, now we're into a third week of this seminar. Next issue. What are the characteristics of a mass tort that compel one type of creative solution versus another? There's a big difference between a 9/11, GM, BP, traumatic explosion, or traumatic injury, or single cause, and chemical mass tort litigation, drug mass tort litigation, medical device mass tort litigation. What are we talking about? What are the characteristics of the tort, of the mass exposure, that compel one roadmap solution versus another? All mass torts are not alike. It's not just asbestos. All mass torts are not alike. In fact, no mass tort, I think, is a carbon copy of another one. So make sure, in sort of as a precondition of coming up with creative solutions. Well, what are the characteristics of that tort that compel a certain roadmap towards solution? Latency, volume, obvious nature, obvious findings of cause and effect, exposure criteria. What's the standard that governs? Proximate cause, clear and convincing, beyond a reasonable doubt, preponderance, what is it? Makes a huge difference. Go back and read, I think it's volume 1. Of even better than that, go back and read Judge Weinstein's book, Individuals and Mass Tort Litigation, that first chapter of that little book, where he spells out the different types of mass torts depending on causation, nature of injury, traumatic versus dispersed, etc. Very, very helpful. Very helpful. That sort of defines, before you come up with solutions, solutions to what? What is the problem? And I think today, certainly we should be focusing on some of those questions. So that's sort of an outline, sort of a breakfast, sort of from 30,000 feet, sort of some keynote issues that I think this audience should consider over the course of an entire day. I mean, what a civilized idea Todd Brown comes up with. How civilized. Let's get the experts in a room, people that understand most of this, and let's let them go down the checklist and let them come up with ideas, solutions, questions, issues, so that at the end of the day, everybody leaves and says, geez, when is that going to be printed? I took 25 pages of notes. Very important, I think. Because at the end, you see, we're in one room at this hotel, but the implication for what you're talking about today, not only practical, real, and current, but the impact is national. And I think that by the end of the day, with the people that are in this crowd and on these panels, just maybe some light will be brought to bear on these 8, 9, 10 issues that are posed. I don't think we spend too much time today with the idiosyncrasies and vagaries of the 9/11 fund or the BP fund or the MGM fund. I think much more importantly today, what do we learn from those funds and from other sources so we can solve within the traditional tort system some of these issues? That, I think, will be a tremendous contribution. Now, according to Mr. Professor Brown here, who's the major domo today, I've left about 15 minutes, which is a beginning at least, and I throw it open for questions. So let's start. Yeah, right. Come on.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure that some of you have questions. Yes, come on up.
One quick question. Can you hear me?
Yes.
How are other countries or societies dealing with this problem, if they are at all? I'm thinking of the subway bombings, the plane crashes, those sorts of things.
Fabulous question. How are other countries dealing with the problem? They don't have the problem. They really don't have the problem. For two reasons. First, no country other than the United States has a litigation system like this one. These alternative programs are alternatives to a mass tort litigation system that is unique to the United States. Second, you got to give Bismarck some credit in 1890 in Germany. Bismarck, over 120 years ago, recognized we better set up a safety net, a social safety net. If you're injured on the job, if you have health needs, if you're destitute, there is cradle to grave some sort of modest protection, financial protection. You look at the health and pension rights of Europeans and Asians when it comes, and Japan, when it comes to what will we do to people through no fault of their own who are injured or killed. We will pay the mortgage, we will pay the car payment, we'll pay their health costs. They don't have to worry. Now, they're not getting $2 million, but the basic necessities are taken care of. I went over to England after the 52 were killed in the terrorist bombing. This was fascinating. I'm invited by Parliament. Mr. Feinberg, we just had this bombing. You did it with 9/11. Please fly over. We want you to meet with the parliamentary committee and go over what you did. I go over. They treated me great. Put me up in a nice hotel. I meet with them. Here's how it worked, 9/11. We set up a system and people could file and in 60 days and we paid. Fabulous. We're thinking of doing something like that ourselves. And how much did you pay them? Well, on average for a death claim with taxpayer money, we paid just a little over $2 million. Next plane home. Next plane. Really? How wonderful. Thank you very much for all your help, Mr. Feinberg. This was a fascinating discussion. The minute they heard about the money as an alternative to the tort system, you know, back to Palookaville, they didn't want to hear anymore about that. The money. So I don't think any country, you don't learn very much from other countries. And other countries, certainly when they read about these programs, I think their reaction is, wow. Not for us, so. Yes, sir, Joe.
Ken, my sense is, because I'm involved in the financing of these litigations, is that a lot of the structure of how these mass torts are resolved really comes from the defendant, and that, I don't know that you mentioned so much in your talk, but the defendant has rights also, and the defendant, and by the way, I'm not a supporter of defendants. I'm just saying that part of the problem is they have the money, and it depends on what motivates them. In other words, if their stock is going to collapse unless they get rid of this unknown liability, they're going to sell it. If the stockholders don't care, then the defendant may take a scorched earth policy and say, try them all, I'm not paying. What is your sense of, how do you see the defendants getting into this sort of...
No, there's no question. Defendants have a key role to play in any solution, if there is one. 9/11 was unique. The defendants, for the most part, were killed by seizing the airplanes. Although I must say, there's plenty of litigation against the World Trade Center, Boeing aircraft, the security guard companies, and all of that. That was taxpayer money. You'll notice, by the way, in 9/11, the government paid out, in that case, the 9/11 fund, paid out to claimants over $7 billion, but reserved the right in the statute to subrogate against the carriers and their insurance companies. Now, of course, that was sheer fantasy. The government was never going to subrogate as a practical matter. You'd think the government was going to go to trial and try and show that it was the airline's fault rather than the government. The government to this day's never apologized for 9/11. That subrogation was always a political fantasy. But sure, it takes defendants. BP decides, you're right, Joe. GM decides, we don't want to go the conventional route. BP says we'll front $20 billion. Front. $20 billion to pay claims. GM says to the world, we don't know what it's going to cost to pay for these defective switches. Ken Feinberg will decide. We agree in advance whatever he says. Now, you don't see that very often. The reason I don't think you'll see another BP oil spill fund for $20 billion is you show me when a company, 5 weeks after a tragedy, fronts $20 billion. You got to be an oil company. I think they did the right thing, GM too, but it takes a defendant. One major reason you don't see more of these funds is the defendant. And one major reason, I guess, you don't see more aggregation is either the defendant or the plaintiff. It's pretty hard to aggregate in the court system when both sides don't want it for different reasons. Defendant doesn't want it. Once we aggregate, we're dead. We got to settle the case. We don't want to. Or we want to aggregate, but the plaintiff says, what happened to my individual claim? And, you know, that's what I learned in law school. I don't want to be just a number. I'm objecting. Absolutely the defendant's key. Yes, sir.
I would like to follow up on a point you made implicitly by pointing Lloyd Dixon. We lawyers need to let scientists, economists, researchers into these efforts to build systems. You look at asbestos, in the Mandel estimate, they missed by 8x. using what they thought was state of the art. So I would point that out as another point for consideration. How do we widen the tent for any other professionals?
I think there is no institution in this country looking at questions like that better and with more thoughtfulness than RAND. RAND is trying to focus now its research on what can we, not the political or the quick fix solution or that which appears to, you know, the spin. What do the facts show about asbestos, about other mass torts, about why people who take free money don't sue? I mean, there's a lot, you're absolutely right in at least raising the generic question, can we learn more about the underlying data that will guide us in better understanding the scope of the problem and maybe some solutions? Yeah, I think that's an avenue we've got to pursue. Asbestos, that's one more reason I think asbestos is a unique nightmare. Predictability, latency, long tail. I'm not sure, as I am fairly certain, looking at asbestos is vastly different than looking at these other mass torts for that reason. A few other questions? Yes, sir.
How do you deal, if at all, with contingency fees on claims where maybe the contingency has been removed now?
In my programs? Nothing to do with me. That's between the claimant and her or his lawyer. I do not, in any one of these, 9/11, BP, GM, and even the private claims, the One Fund Boston or Newtown or legal fees, for me, irrelevant. I don't add a legal fee component into my calculations. I don't deduct it. I don't in any way interfere with whatever contractual relationship that claimant has with his or her lawyer. It's none of my business. I'd be crazy. Lawyers are already upset enough with these alternative programs without me adding fuel to the fire by attempting to regulate private contractual understandings between claimants and their lawyers. Now, in 9/11, Congress insisted in the regulations, not the statute, that we add a regulation that said it is in the opinion of the administrator that a legal fee in processing the 9/11 claim should be no more than 5%. It didn't matter. Either the lawyers ignored it, or for the most part, they did it pro bono anyway. Guys like Jim, so it didn't really matter. Joe and Trial Lawyers Care took it on, 1,500 people pro bono. But I stay out of that, because if I get into that hornet's nest, I got enough problems. Yes, sir. Professor.
Yes, hi. Just a follow-up question from on Mark's question. To what extent do you design your compensation program to reduce the need for a lawyer? Could someone collect without a lawyer at all?
Yes. Could somebody collect from one of my programs without a lawyer? Sure, there's no requirement. I'll bet in GM so far, roughly 25% have no lawyers. In BP, probably half had no lawyers. In 9/11, probably 15% had no lawyers. Fine, there's two reasons. It doesn't matter whether you have a lawyer or not. One, we make the program, it's not an adversarial system, so we try and make the program as a fiduciary, as eased as possible, so that lawyer technical skills aren't required. That's one point I make. Secondly, I love the lawyers. In these programs, having a lawyer has turned out to be, I think, a benefit. The lawyers understand the program, can explain to their clients the program. I prefer the lawyers. I can tell you, without the 9/11 Joe's Trial Lawyers Care, without those lawyers, the program would have never achieved success to the tune of 97%. So we don't draft the program with lawyers in mind, but we encourage it. We tell them it's up to you, claimant. It's non-adversarial, but if you want a lawyer, by all means, you're not penalized, and frankly, we welcome it. In GM, we are finding that lawyers represent a whole inventory of clients so that a lawyer can file 50 claims, and we're dealing with one lawyer for 50 people, and that makes it more efficient. Yes, sir.
I want to ask a question based on your comment early on that the compensation funds are precedents for nothing. I can't tell whether you think that's a good thing or a bad thing. And here's one reason it might be a good thing. It might be a good thing because these are, as you say, really rare events. They're totally unique. And in each case, there are a number of factors that will control whether it's a good idea to provide some process, whether providing process is impossible, how much people need to get. So doesn't that suggest that actually having a one-off ad hoc approach in the shadow of a process-heavy tort system actually works? And let me just say, I study the history of judicial institutions, and that's where aggregation comes from. Aggregation is an equitable procedure. It comes out of chancery. You can't fit your claim into the cumbersome and slow and problematic common law system. Well, let's get everyone together in front of the chancellor. We'll get everyone paid off, and the situation is satisfied. That actually works in some cases. So is it, in your judgment, okay to kind of stumble along and put these things together one at a time? Or do you need to have some kind of systematic resolution?
Well, that's, you know, that's a great question. My view is, I think, that the big problem I have with these unique funds is they're politically inequitable. Now, life is inequitable, I guess. But I have problems when I get a call from an Exxon Valdez victim who's been waiting for her money for 20 years, asking me, why is my next door neighbor getting BP money next week and I've been waiting for 20 years? Or my son died in Oklahoma City, or my daughter died in the basement of the World Trade Center 10 years earlier, where's my money? I mean, I have a real political, philosophic problem with carving out these programs as historically apt as they may be, and perhaps helping the judiciary going forward see how it can be done, but not on the backs of innocent victims who don't have access to this system. So I sort of come down with two answers. One, I think probably in the short run, it's a bad idea. Now, maybe if you're storing nuts for winter and you're going back to chancery in the 15th century and you're going to work your way up over the next 500 years, maybe there's some storing, you know, planting seeds for the future. Maybe. But I've got problems with these now as sort of precedent. Secondly, I must say, and even though this is a little glib, it doesn't really matter what I think. You're just not going to see these programs very often. Now, maybe I could say, we ought to encourage this. This is wonderful, assuming you can get over my philosophic aversion. My saying it isn't going to make it so. It really isn't. I mean, how many times I ask anybody, I don't know a company that's fronted $20 billion, and I don't know a 9/11 fund paying with taxpayer money. I can't believe you're ever going to see that again. Didn't see it in Katrina. Didn't see it in Katrina. Tornadoes, earthquakes. You don't see a plan like 9/11. And in Katrina, believe me, there are people that get annoyed and very angry. What about me and Katrina? They had this 9/11 fund, and I didn't get any money in Katrina. I don't know. I have problems with it. Good question. I don't know. Yes, sir.
To follow up on that, if you've done a lot of these funds, if you were to create another one, say for Katrina, is there any particular thing in the creation of that fund that you would say you need to do this?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Give everybody the same amount of money and don't tie it to the tort system. If you want to compensate people who have been damaged or killed or injured by a disaster, pay them. But don't say stockbroker, banker, lawyer, you're going to get more from me than waiter, busboy, cop, fireman, or soldier. You know why? Because it's an alternative to the tort system, and we got to encourage people voluntarily to opt out of the tort system. And if you give the stockbroker the same amount of money as the busboy, the stockbroker isn't going to opt out of the tort system. So, and if that's your goal, everybody gets a different amount of money. I much prefer, you're asking me point blank, a system like One Fund Boston, Aurora, Colorado, Newtown. You lost a loved one? You're all getting $300,000, $500,000, $1 million. I don't care if the victim was one or 100, a banker or a cop. You're getting the same amount of money. And do with it will you will. Trouble with that, of course, is BP, GM, won't set up the system. If one size fits all, we're not going to set up. We want releases. That's what we want. Because we want releases because we don't buy your anecdotal argument that if we give people money for nothing, they won't sue. We'll wait for the RAND study to show us why they won't sue. We want a release. Well, if you want a release from the, if your system is tied to the hip of the tort system, everybody's going to get a different amount of money, and that's going to piss off everybody. And it does. I mean, I'm dealing with angry people who say, it's not about the money, but why is my next door neighbor getting two times what I'm getting? I don't care if it's a dollar. What do you have against my wife who died? You never even met my wife, and you've cut her compensation by half next to my next-door neighbor. Why? You didn't even meet her. Well, the tort system, you know, and we're trying to... Oh, please. You know how far that gets you? This far. So, we could go on all day and week with this. I hope I've laid out some ground rules, maybe, or agenda items that may prove useful throughout the day, and it should be a very exciting and informative day indeed. Thanks.